Let's start off this morning by taking and working upon the health of our bodies. If you would you sit back in your chairs, both feet flat on the floor, ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable to you. And let your eyes close and just think along with me, if you would. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments to enter into the innermost world of my own mind and consciousness. To, in this world, enter into a state of beingness and awareness, a state of awareness that lets me know that I am part of the greater consciousness of the universe, which is right here in my body. For the reason that I have consciousness is that the consciousness of the infinite dwells here within me. And in that indwelling consciousness lies the secret to all health and healing. And so let me feel that at the very center of my mind now, an inner light glows, a state of consciousness and a state of beingness, a state of awareness that enters into all of the cells of my body, from the top of my head down the length of my body to the soles of my feet. And as this happens, my body breathes easier, deeper, and more comfortably. And I move now into a deep cushion of consciousness, as if my very body is bathed, soothed, and caressed in a higher reality, a higher state of being, that every cell of my body is being touched by the light of God that dwells within me. And as that happens, the rhythms, the motions, and the energies of each and one of the trillions of cells of my body is being set into the divine rhythm for good health and healing. That there is a divine design that the creative consciousness within me created for the entirety of my body, that it might function perfectly, and that perfection right here and right now is part of the rhythm and motion of each and every cell, outwardly and inwardly. And as I feel this now, I am part of this, part of this great consciousness at all levels of my being, body, mind, and soul. And that throughout all levels of my mind now, that light is entering, sublimating all trauma, all negativity, all karma into light, bathing my very mind and my very soul with the life-giving energies of God and the universe. Here within myself, the beauty, the majesty, the goodness that is God vibrates throughout the entirety of my beingness, body, mind, and soul. And I am part of that consciousness, and that consciousness is part of me. And every breath that I breathe into my body is in divine harmony with the harmony of consciousness that exists throughout me, surrounding me. And I sit in an aura of pure, white, godlike light, protected from outer disturbances, in a state of serenity within myself, a state of peace, and a state of beauty. For I am a part of this, and it is a part of me. beauty, peace, the quietude of the divine encircling me and unfolding from within me. And I am in a state of healingness, wholeness, and health, blended with the light, fused with the light, the entirety of my being in one synthesis with the light. In wholeness, in completeness, I sit and am in a state of divine well-beingness. All is in a state of balance. All is in a state of polarity. All is in a state of harmony throughout the entirety of my body, my mind, and my soul. For this realization of health and of healing, this morning I give thanks. I let it be so, and so it is. All right, let's start with the mystical secrets to prospering. Let's pull out our affirmation sheet. Now, I know that there are enormous amounts of ideas as far as how to prosper, and most of them are built nowadays around different kinds of seminars that are given all over the country, different so-called experts on how to prosper. Most of what is being taught, even if it's not in a spiritual sense, is drawn from what we call Western metaphysics. The ideas that have been taught in within what we call the New Thought movement for many, many years are now presented in formats that are motivational or motivational speakers. While all of these can help to a certain degree, they are not really the essence of what real prosperity really is. And what I want to go over with you here is the mystical aspect of prosperity, not the new thought, not the metaphysical. The new thought and the metaphysical basically is prosperity 101. It is an entry level. It is an entry level to understand what real prosperity is. Now, John Glushko gave some definitions from the dictionary this morning, but probably the greatest way to approach it was if you understood the inner meanings of Christ as he spoke through Jesus, that there is a different way to approach being prosperous. Let's suppose that a person was in a state of Christ consciousness most of the time. They would be not thinking about, I'm going to practice the law of attraction. That, I mean, is so infantile because it has nothing to do with real prosperity. You can only go so far by practicing any of the lesser laws, but you can go the entirety of the way by being just plainly prosperous. But what do I mean by prosperous? Prosperous not in the way that we think of ordinary prosperity, how Christ thought of prosperity and how he taught it. Let's look at the first affirmation. It says, seek first. It says, to have all things added to my life, I seek first the higher consciousness of God's presence or the kingdom of heaven within me. In the New Testament, it says, seek first the kingdom of heaven and all things shall be added unto you. All things, the word all things shall be added unto you. What does that mean? It means if you can get into a state of consciousness that is part of the Christ consciousness, which means that part of your mind that is one with the eternal, infinite, universal consciousness, that the creative consciousness of that consciousness will think through you, see through your senses, and interpret life through your senses. In other words, as you look out through the, into the world, it is not you, John, Mary, Hank, Henry, thinking to yourself, well, if I think positive, I'm going to attract positive things to me. But let's suppose that deep down inside of yourself, you're filled with trauma, karma, negativity, DNA, etc., etc. You are a proverbial house divided against itself from the opening round. That is, you are divided in a state of consciousness. The cerebral part of you is saying, I attract because I am one with God. That's the usual metaphysical way. But the other part of you that's filled with negativity, trauma, and karma is saying, oh no, you jackass, you really are not. You are a loser. You have lost and lost and lost and lost. You are a victim. What are you trying to do up there in the cerebral part of your consciousness? You're trying to play tricks on me? I've been your companion all of these years. Shouldn't you just go along with me? And then when the least little setback comes along, you cave into all of that negativity. You stop saying, I'm one with God, and therefore I'm prosperous, and the entirety of the universe is mine. You stop saying those things because you have doubt at that particular point. After all, the outside environment has shown you, demonstrated to you, look at, you've lost, your business has collapsed, you've lost a new love, whatever it might be. Now, Jesus put it very, very simply, again, the Christ speaking through Jesus, to seek first the kingdom of heaven. Now, that isn't very enticing to most people today. They would rather seek what they think are just momentary ways to become prosperous. But prosperity, as John sort of mentioned, encompasses the entirety of what it means to be prosperous. If you're materially prosperous and you don't have love in your life, what is the point of the material prosperity? You have nobody to share it with, nobody to enjoy it with. If you don't have your health, if you've sold out your health, stressing out your body, working and working and working and working to accumulate material, and then in the end you find yourself laying in bed with a nightstand that's filled with all kinds of medications, what is the point? There is no point. You're neutralized. You're a neutralized person. You're a neutralized soul. And so the first thing, the first priority of life is to seek oneness with that which is all things. Because if in consciousness you become one with all that is all things then are immediately a part of your life's experience. You don't have to play these little games of, oh, I'm going to attract this, or if I put so many things in my wishful piggy bank over here, my wish list, or I've got this chart up on the board so I can focus in on all the things that I really want. Oh, sweet people. That will only get you so far. But it won't carry you with God's healing love and grace working in and through you. So the next thing says meditation, which is this doorway to seeking first. It says, through my daily practice of meditation, I open my conscious awareness to God's presence, who in turn provides the intuition, sensing, and guidance necessary to prosper. If you don't have the intuitive process going, you have a cerebral process going, which means then you have to borrow the thoughts of others. I want you to think about what I just said. In order to succeed, if you don't have intuition going, you have to borrow the thoughts of others. If you borrow the thoughts of others, it is not unique to yourself and what your soul cries out to do in this lifetime. Thus, you are not living your soul's purpose. Think. Think about what I just said. So who wants to borrow the thoughts of others? Do you wish to be just a duplication of other people that you see there, foreign to your own soul, in the country of your own body and your own mind and your own spirit? It makes no sense. None. When you meditate every day, the cerebral part is open to the higher consciousness inside of you, which gives you these intuitive insights and guidance. At the same time, it helps to heal this garbage can of negativity, of trauma that's festering inside from childhood or previous lives. So that on one part, God is leading and guiding you intuitively, and another part, as you're meditating, God is healing you from within of these things that need divine healing. Why do they need divine healing? Why divine? Can't you just go to a therapist? Because your personality has not been able to do it on its own. I want you to think about what I just said. Your personality has not been able to do it on its own. We all are familiar with the expression divine intervention?
Yes.
Well, a person who is filled with negativity needs divine intervention. They need to be cleansed from the inside, washed from the inside, bathed from the inside, purified from the inside. It is not what goeth into the mouth of a man that defileth a man, but what issueth forth. What we have inside, what we are inside. And so meditation gives us this access not only to be intuitively guided in terms of what real prosperity is, but to be in tune with what our soul's purpose is. Because it doesn't matter if you prosper, if you're not in tune with your soul's purpose, you're going to find a void in your life, and you're going to fill it with drugs, and you're going to fill it with alcohol and gambling and every other type of escapism. You want to play the percentages? Then let the house rule, and the house is the house that you live in, and the house is the house of God. The body is the temple. It is the only true church. It is the only true synagogue. It is the only true cathedral. That's it. You're it. It begins and it ends in you. Only when you make that choice. Next, personal will to God's will. I daily turn over my personal will to God's will. For it is God's presence, wisdom, power, and creativity that is prospering itself. God's presence is prospering itself. As I have run things over a period of years, I go along with what Christ said And as Jesus felt this within himself, I of myself do nothing. It is the Father within me that doeth these good works. Only when you realize that you have, the personal part of you has absolutely nothing to do with your prosperity, do you reach the first rung of the ladder of wisdom. You begin to realize that there is a power and a consciousness that supersedes all of the slickness, all of the cunning, all of the mental manipulations of intellect. You begin to realize this. You see those that prosper in a material sense, but are disconnected from their source or God. And you see a lot of the unhappiness that they experience within themselves. So every day, in order to prosper, it is not your will, but God's will, because God is the only true life in our body. Everything else is make-believe. Everything else is a con job. You don't exist on a personal level. You think you do, and that's part of the twist of creation, to make us all feel that there's more than one of us, because ultimately there's only one life in this universe posing itself as every one of us. The moment you begin to realize this, you come to those words, I of myself, personal ego, can do nothing. It is the Father which doeth these good works. Now, I know, you see, we're brought up in our Western culture. We're brought up with, you got to do this, you got to succeed at that, you got to focus in on this, you got to concentrate in on this, you got to will this to happen. Everything puts the stress on you, my friends. Everything tears your system down. Just be. The words in the Bible, I am. I am. If you are, you are everything that is. That means that whatever your particular manifestation of the one life is supposed to experience in this lifetime in terms of prosperity, you are on spiritual automatic and will experience. And that's a term that I've used for many years, to live in spirit on spiritual automatic, just like a pilot that flies a plane and puts it on automatic. The same situation. You put your life on automatic. You get up, you walk out the door in the morning, and you know what you should say? Let it happen. Let it happen. Not I'm going to do this when I get to the office, and then I'm going to do that, and I'm going to tell this son of a gun that, and I'm going to tell that son of a gun that, and I'm going to let them all know. Or else I'm going to go and I'm going to try to get everybody's sympathy. And I'm going to be a victim. Maybe they should have a victim song. Already so. Everybody is seeking prosperity. If I do this, I'll be prosperous. If I do that, I'll be prosperous. If I do this, if I follow this law, if I follow that principle, if I do this affirmation, if I do that affirmation, if I belong to a certain religion, if I choose my parents wisely on my next incarnation. I mean, think about it. Says, already so, I recognize that whatever I can be already is in a moment of eternal time, including prospering. Now, I'm going to ask you to stretch your minds for just a moment. Stretch it into the infinite mind inside of you. You're here, and prosperity is over there somewhere. You say, I've got to spend time to get from non-prosperity to prosperity. And I'm saying to you, everything exists in one eternal moment. The prosperity that you hope for, you already have. You already are. The prosperity that you hope for, you already have, you already are. It is the presence of God within yourself. So if you're already prosperous in the mind of God in this one eternal moment of time, why not choose to live it now? What speck of the eternal moment do you choose? The speck that says poverty, lack, living day to day, or that which says, I already am prosperous? You say, I just checked my balance. No, I'm not prosperous. And I'm saying, keep thinking that way and then go check it again. I've seen this. You know, self-image is one thing when you say, I'm going to have a positive self-image. That's good. But it isn't mystical. And why would you want to be mystical? Because the word mysticism really means union with God. It means the pursuit of union with God. Of course, that is, as John said, mysterious. It is mysterious until we're ready and we have come to the point where we have beat our heads against the proverbial wailing wall long enough, drawn enough psychic blood that we're ready to say, that's it, I've had it. It's not going to be any longer. I am that which I am. So you choose then, through my oneness with God's eternal presence, I choose prospering as my experience of the one eternal moment. Let me repeat this. God, cut it out and put it on your refrigerator. Look at it every day. It's just as important as what you might get out to eat, because this is food for the soul. Through my oneness with God's eternal presence, I choose prospering as my experience of the one eternal moment. You see, the one eternal moment contains poverty. It contains hardship. It contains all of these things that souls go through. But it also contains your prosperity. The thing is to make the choice of what part of that one eternal moment do you resonate with right now. So then it says, I am. In I am oneness with God's presence, I need not try to attract anything. I pause right there to let you think about that. I do not try to attract anything. But you say, this goes against what all these self-help books have been saying. This goes against what all of these teachers have been saying. Good friends, I of myself do nothing. Seek first the kingdom of heaven, and all things shall be added unto you. It's simple. No man shall enter the kingdom of heaven except he who does the will of my Father. All of these are built into the affirmations. So, it's your choice. In spirituality, you can wallow in the sandbox, or you can go up to a university and a graduate level. The choice is yours. Each soul will only vibrate to that level which they're ready for. In churches and classes and so forth that have emphasized these types of things about attracting and so on and so forth, I've been around this for a half a century. And I can tell you the same people that came in 50 years ago can still be sitting in there, and except for getting a good massage and false hope, they still sit there and they're still worrying about how to pay their bills. And in a bad economy as we're having right now, it's tough. So what I'm saying is, let's cut through all of the nonsense, all of the garbage, and say, I am that which I am. I of myself can do nothing. It is the Father, not I. That's what it says in the New Testament. It is the Father, not I, that doeth these good works. Why call ye me good? So we have to divorce ourselves of our personal ego. It's not just prospering, but everything on the face of this earth that causes people to have fear, to have conflict, to have envy, to have jealousy. Every single one of the human maladies is always the result of our personal egos. He who loses himself finds himself, and he who finds himself finds that he is already prosperous. Get the dumbbell inside of you out of the way, is what I'm saying. The dumbbell will want to stay in the sandbox and play with the other kids and say, oh, if I just do this, I will attract that, and I will attract I. Well, what I is talking? The personal I, the bufo I. Bufo in Greek means dumbbell. I threw in a little bit of my heritage there. So you choose the one eternal moment, and then you live the I am, in I am oneness with God's presence. I need not try to attract anything, for I already am all that I could seek to attract. And being all things, I am already prosperous. You might say, wow, is that a rationalization? Is it really? Take a look at people's lives if you want to see rationalization. Struggling. Hurting. I don't want to see you people hurt. I don't want to see you struggle. I don't want to think if your car breaks down, how are you going to pay to have it fixed? I don't want to think if the water heater goes out, how are you going to pay to have it fixed? I don't want you to have to worry if inflation is running away right now. And as it came out this past week in the United States, for those of you that are outside of the country, inflation going up 5.8%, but wage earnings coming down 3.1%. Now, you got something to think about, but why think about it? I'm already prosperous, but you say, I'm only earning so much. Yes, because you're not already prosperous in your consciousness. But how do I become prosperous? You sure as hell don't do it by constantly just affirming and affirming and affirming and be in a state of disconnect with a God presence inside of you. You can't have it both ways. That's the one thing in spirituality. You can't have it both ways. That's what Christ meant. You cannot serve God and mammon. You know, render unto the politicians what are the politicians, and render unto God's, which is your body, temple, your soul, your mind, what is God's. I know. It's a whole lot. But what's the alternative? Woe is me. I think I'll call up my neurotic friend. And we'll commensurate together. We'll talk about how bad it is. Unseen. Not only are you intuitively guided when you're in a state of connection internally, not only are you intuitively guided, but in the unseen realm of universal mind and consciousness, the unseen realm of universal mind and consciousness, there are certain energies, because you're part of the ebb and flow now of universal consciousness. And that universal consciousness sets into motion various laws, various principles, various energies that will draw certain people to you. bring people into your sphere of experience. At the same time, it will push away the hustlers, the ones that always are waving something in front of you and saying, hey, you attend my seminar, you're going to get this, that, and the other thing. You follow my way of political thinking, you're going to get this, that, and the other thing. Most politicians are hucksters.
Absolutely.
If you haven't learned that by now, God bless you. And it isn't just, you know, on a lower level I'm talking about. I mean, it goes up. You know, we have the old expression, power corrupts.
Oh, yes.
So don't expect them to save you. Don't expect me to save you. Don't expect anybody to save you. You've got to save yourself. And you do this by being yourself, your real self. So it says, in the consciousness of God in the universe, God's will is in motion in the unseen realm of spirit to energize my prospering. That's powerful. To energize my prospering. There are things that are being handled. In other words, in the realm of universal mind, there's the great puppeteer. And the all of his creations, his, her creations, however you care to choose to think about God, are under the strings. And so the strings are going to work that somebody's going to come into close to you. Different things taking place. Laws set into motion. You're energized. Your life is energized. You know, when a person is prospering, I want you to think back, any of you that have had a prosperous period in your life or prosperous cycle in your life. How did you feel? How did you vibrate? Did you feel something different? Did you feel like maybe you were in like what the athlete calls the zone? How many of you felt that? I know that I'm not up here by myself just whispering strange things. Now, whatever you felt, and if you haven't felt it, just imagine that you're out in the springtime somewhere and there's out in a meadow somewhere and everything is beautiful and the temperature is just right and a cool breeze passes through you. And it's just like you just feel just one with nature, what we call extroverted mysticism. And you just feel that you're in that wonderful, wonderful zone.
Peace.
It's the same thing when you're in that prosperous type of situation. You feel differently. There's an energy. Notice I said the word energy. But here, what I'm talking about is primal energy. The first cause energy of the universe, from which all other energies come forth from. Finally, then, attitude. My attitude is one of positiveness about prospering, due to my oneness with God's presence, established through meditation and releasing of my personal will to God's will, not every other day, not once a month, daily. So you don't seek prosperity, you are prosperity. You don't have to go from point A to point B. You already are there. It is a matter of claiming what you already are. I remember many years ago when I was doing a television show on PBS in the LA market. The first taping we had, I think I was in my early 30s at that particular time, and I think I had one blue suit to my name, something like that. And because of this was a new television show, they went and got me a new suit to dress up in, one of those big collar jobs with the wide ties that was popular in the early 70s, those of you that might go back into a psychedelic state of consciousness. And after the taping, I had this student of mine that came up to the stage and got my attention. I said, yes. He said, you know, Dr. Masters, I'm so happy that you're finally successful. And I said, you know, I've been successful right along. You just haven't noticed. Now, imagine if you said this to yourself. I've been successful right along. I just haven't noticed. Rationalization? Kidding oneself? What is the alternative? If I was a poor man and a victim thrown in. Now, real prosperity, and then the mystical secrets of real prosperity, is to be one with all prosperity. All prosperity is to be one with the spirit, the infinite, that is within you, as you, living you, and to be in a Christ mind state of consciousness. Christ mind meaning that state of mentality within yourself where you are one with God. All right, now, let's take a few moments to go into a state of meditation. And I'm going to ask if you would you let your eyes close, put both feet flat on the floor, turn inward. I close my eyes to the exterior world. That I may open my eyes to the interior world within myself. I turn my mind in upon itself and my outer senses inward. To begin to sense and to feel the reality of the wholeness and oneness of universal consciousness here within myself. Look within my mind's eye to begin to see and catch glimpses of that which is within me and yet at the same time infinitely beyond me. For I breathe the life and breath of spirit throughout my body, the consciousness of Almighty God dwelling here within me and yet infinitely beyond me. I open my mind, body, and soul at all levels to the light of universal presence, that I may come to realize that the only life that really lives within me is universal presence, and that I, my identity, is one with universal presence. That universal presence contains all within itself, and I contain my individualized share of that universal presence. That by living my soul's purpose, which is known by universal presence, I prosper because I am living that which I am supposed to live, whether I am starting out life or just in the final years. I am that which I am, one, whole, and complete. I am in a higher state of reality and consciousness, in a higher state of beingness, in a consciousness that knows my every need, for it is, and I am its manifestation. And so I turn over my personal will to the will and presence of God within me, my intellect to be used as a tool in the hands of infinite mind and spirit. Open totally, completely, in consciousness, to pure consciousness, pure mind, God's presence here within myself. I sit now in the quiet, the peace, the beauty that is God's presence here within myself, that I may find the peace that gives peace to my soul, that I may find the harmony to harmonize my life with God, whether I am beginning the initial stages of my life or coming towards the end of it. Let me recognize that I am both Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And I choose the abundant part of that experience. And now ever so slowly, let me begin to slowly open my eyes. And as I do, let me retain that presence that is within me, raising my arms and hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher in my life, and knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars and of the heavens, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring down my hands, resting in the peace that this is so, and so it is.